This is Jedi General Pong Krail. I welcome you to the Voice of the Republic podcast. Listen to this podcast. That is an order.
Your reputation precedes you, General. The reputation of a great new podcast.
Hello, Star Wars fans across the galaxy. Welcome to the Voice of the Republic podcast. My name is Daniel, and joining me is fellow host Ruari Williamson.
What's up, fellow geeks?
So, third week, well, it would be fourth if we didn't have technical problems, but anyway, yeah, third week in a row, so this is good.
Third episode, it's not in a row if you miss
a week. Oh, we can just pretend that never happened.
But I'm no good at pretending, it's fixed right in my brain.
I forgot about that, actually. So we've got some pretty awesome guests today. Do you want to introduce them, Ruari?
We have Victoria, a.k.a. Scruffy Rebel, the well-known cosplayer. How are you doing, Victoria?
Doing pretty good. Thanks for having me.
And we have Bonnie Piesse, is it? I can never
Yes, that's correct.
Yay.
Yeah, I deserve a medal for that.
I'll get you a medal later, don't worry.
Anyway, Bonnie was the actress behind Beru Lez in the prequel trilogy of Star Wars. So how are you doing, Bonnie?
Very well, thank you.
You're
it's a pleasure
welcome.
To be on the line with you.
And it's great to have both of you on this podcast.
Yep.
So, Bonnie, did you want to talk about your upcoming music EP and the fundraising campaign you have to help you make it?
Yeah, so I've been a musician for a really long time, and I actually had a record deal and made an album and ended up leaving the record label and am now going independent, which it's interesting the way the music industry has changed so much and how easy it is really for people to actually get music made themselves by using crowdfunding platforms. So I'm using Indiegogo and, you know, getting all the Star Wars fans involved in raising the money. And it's going really well. I've actually been in the studio. We've recorded four tracks, and they're sounding amazing. And it's so exciting that I can, you know, create this myself and then release it directly to the fans. It's really fun.
Yeah, I mean,
yeah.
I was listening to some of the music today, and it's just really goodly done and all that.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, there are some tracks from the older album actually online. You can't buy them, but you can listen to them. And it's a similar sound. The new one's a little more kind of raw. There's a very cinematic feel to it. Like all these songs, I could really hear them in movies and TV shows, which is what I wanted.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's a little more raw, acoustic, kind of emotional sounding. But.
Yeah, that's really cool. And then how much money have you been trying to raise for it?
Sorry, I didn't hear that.
How much money have you been trying to fundraise for the EP?
Yeah. So my goal on Indiegogo is 8,000 US.
And you've
that's
already,
kind of the Yeah, that's kind of... I've already raised 6,000.
Yeah.
I'm going to need to raise, it looks like actually 11 for the whole thing, but I have other investors and stuff for the remainder, but I'm hoping that we'll do the 8 on Indiegogo or exceed that would be awesome.
Yeah, definitely, that would be great.
Yeah,
and
but it's
Daniel,
such a cool experience. Like, it's so interesting how, like, being in the studio really, like, I'm so aware of the fact that all these fans have helped me do this dream would not be coming true without everyone's help, so it's pretty amazing. Yeah.
And I just have to interrupt and interject something here. Daniel, I swear, the next time I hear you typing,
it's not me.
Is it?
No.
I'm the culprit. I should have let Daniel take the fall.
Don't worry, I'm used to this now. I get blamed for everything.
With good reason.
I thought it was some nice sound effects, actually.
Not for me. Well... I just thought Daniel straight away because he always blames me for my apparent note typing.
So I just like, you guys can
yeah,
each
we
other.
We just got to a stage when we blame each other for the typing mistakes. So my apologies to you, Daniel.
Apology accepted.
It's the only apology you'll get for a while. Oh god. And anyway, Daniel, did you have any questions you would like to ask?
Yeah.
Bonnie.
I've got one. Let's see. What was it like being part of such a big project like Star Wars?
It was crazy. I mean, like, I was not a big Star Wars fan when I got the role, but I did know what it was, and I was aware of how huge it was. And I just found the whole experience really surreal. I remember I was 16, so I was in school, and this was kind of out of the blue. I'd been doing TV shows in Australia, which were really fun, but, like, a much lower scale. So I found myself at 16, suddenly I was sitting in the dressing room, and I looked at myself in the mirror. This is on the first day. And I actually looked like I was out of Star Wars. And it was such an odd thing. And then I walked onto set, and there was George Lucas saying, "Welcome, make yourself at home." And then Natalie Portman was there to welcome me, and we did a little scene, actually a dialogue scene, which didn't get into episode 2. I'm really hoping it gets on the deleted scenes.
If you don't mind me interrupting, Bonnie, I've actually read the dialogue from that scene.
Yeah? You've read it somewhere?
Yeah, I haven't seen the scene, but I have read it. It was like they were preparing this tray or something for a meal, and, like, they talk about Naboo and Tatooine.
Yeah.
And I don't know, I'm trying to remember. I can't at this moment.
Remember.
Something like that.
Yeah, I've read it too. I believe it's in a book somewhere. So yeah. That you can get hold of the dialogue. It was a cute little kind of girly scene between my character Beru and Padme. So that was cool. That was my first scene ever, and I was a little overwhelmed. It's like, whoa, I'm in Star Wars. This is crazy.
Daniel and Victoria, I'll make sure to send you a book later, because I'll look at
Yeah, we can sort that out after.
Yeah.
So,
like, I definitely know Naboo and Tatooine were mentioned or indirectly mentioned at some point in it. Like, I think, like, Bonnie, you were to, as Beru were to say something like, you don't like hot desert planets or something like that. No. What am I thinking?
Something along those lines. And I know that it has been released, so it's not, like, a bad spoiler for me to say this, but it was, like, something along the lines of, asking...
That Beru doesn't like the kind of planets that Naboo is.
Huh?
That, it was along the lines of Beru doesn't like the kind of planet that Naboo is, you know.
Yeah, exactly. I'm like, I prefer it here.
Yeah. let me just say, listeners, I am absolutely worthless at thinking after 9 p.m. anymore.
Oh. I kind of gathered that when 9 p.m. hit. So I see you've got a couple of questions, Rami.
A couple equals two. I have three.
Yeah.
Even after 9 p.m. I just win these debates.
Even after 9 p.m. you can still troll and win debates. Just wait, we've still got an entire podcast ahead. I might have some tricks up my sleeve.
You never do. So, Bonnie, my first question is, what was your reaction after landing the role of Beru Lez?
Oh, I was absolutely shocked. And my mom came to school where I was studying at the time, and she came, like, screaming across the courtyard. I heard, like, this, outside. And then a friend of mine came into the library where I was studying, and she said, "Your mom just came screaming across the courtyard." And so I went out and found my mom, and she just couldn't contain herself. She was jumping around like crazy, and she just said, you got it, and we just both, like, jumped around squealing and, like, laughing, and then the whole school kind of joined us. We got a huge gathering of people, and word spread pretty fast, so that was pretty fun.
That is actually extremely cool.
I'd be a bit...
The way you could share in that moment, that's just really...
I'd be embarrassed. First, I'd be embarrassed for my mum, like, running across doing that, but...
It didn't even cross my mind. I was just, like, so blown away. I mean, how often do you get a call saying that, you know, George Lucas wants you to be in Star Wars and go and shoot in Northern Africa?
I don't think me or Rari will get...
Well, no, Daniel, I won't be so sure about that. Well, I'm totally sure in your case, but on my case, well, that's a different matter. He might ask me to write for the Clone Wars.
In your dreams.
No, I don't dream about stuff.
Oh, okay, fair enough. Anyway.
Yeah, and my second question is, where were your films seen, and what was it like filming there?
Yeah, so for episode 2, we filmed some in Sydney. So my first day was in Sydney. That was on the huge set. And then we went to Tunisia, Northern Africa, for about a week and a half. And that was so crazy, like very surreal to be out there on the original kind of place where they filmed it, and the Sahara, and, you know, you see the moisture evaporators in the background. That was cool, but it was also great that we got to spend a lot of time, you know, with George, with Natalie and Hayden, because we got to travel around with them and have dinner and hang out by the pool at the hotel, you know. It was great. We got to bond.
Yeah, it's really cool. And my final question is, I hear you've been to a lot of conventions, including Celebration 6 this year. What has been your favorite convention experience?
You know, I still got to stick with Celebration 2, which was my first. I had no idea what to expect. I didn't even really know that there was such a thing as conventions. But someone invited me, so I was like, okay, sure, I'll go. So I went, and Joel Edgerton and I, who played Owen, we met up and we were kind of walking through the streets of Indianapolis, and suddenly someone recognized us. It's like, there's Aunt Beru, there's Uncle Owen. And sure enough, like, there were a bunch of stormtroopers that started following us down the street. and then it was just crazy. I mean, I was just meeting people and signing autographs and, you know, having photos taken and doing panels the whole weekend. And it was just, yeah, very, very shocking and amazing and surreal, but really fun too. So that's definitely my favorite.
Yeah, that's really cool. Has anyone else got any questions for Bonnie?
Don't think so. Victoria, have you got anything to ask?
No, I am good. You guys asked all the questions I would.
We have it all planned out.
And even then, my dad, I actually compared my questions first with other interviews I'd seen with Bonnie to make sure I didn't steal too much.
I don't have my questions in until like an hour before the show anyway.
That's good.
Like, what am I saying? In the last two shows, the one with Chris, like Chris Edgerly from the Clone Wars, and you, Bonnie, like, I just, like, came up with the questions while writing the notes, literally. It wasn't even a plan, you just wrote them down while writing the notes and, like, comparing with those interviews I mentioned.
Sorry, I'm having trouble hearing you. Can you say that again?
Like, what I was saying was, like, I, these days, like, in the last 2 weeks, I only, wrote my questions or compared with interviews while actually doing the notes at the same time on Fridays. It's like basically like with schoolwork and all that, I'm just so busy, like I only get the notes done on Friday.
you used to like stress me and want them all done by Monday.
Well, good job.
Then I told you to lay off me and let me leave.
But, like, the problem is, if you do them on Monday, a lot of stuff can happen, like, in Star Wars until Friday, so yeah. It's kind of like, oh, now we have to add this, that, this type of thing.
Yeah. We, like, did the notes for the first episode of Dave Benoit on, like, a Saturday or Sunday, I think.
Yeah, it was, like, literally a week before he was going to come on.
And there wasn't even any news, we didn't have to worry about it.
Well, no, but we started to pick more stuff up anyway, so.
Yeah,
so we've got a couple of Facebook questions for you.
Awesome.
Have we?
Daniel, you're reading them out.
Have we got any have we? Yeah.
Yeah, we've got four.
Oh, yeah, you've made a mistake there on the script. You've put Victoria's questions.
No, that's just a... Okay. I did that with Adam's. I've got it mixed up.
My screen froze when I saw it anyway. So, questions from Facebook. Zach Genko asks, how was it meeting Natalie Portman?
Oh, it was awesome. You know, I first met her, actually before we got on set, I met her briefly. She saw me, actually. I was just waiting in the hallway while she was getting her makeup done. And she saw me and really, she came over and like gave me a hug and said, welcome, you know, so great to have you here. And I thought that was really nice. So she went out of her way to try to make me feel comfortable and like a part of the family there. And I like, since then, I've actually become more and more of a fan of her work. I think she's amazing.
Yeah.
So I would love to meet her again.
Yeah. So also, Johnny Beggs asks, were you a fan of the original trilogy growing up?
I wasn't. And actually, I've been booed at some conventions for that.
That's not nice.
Let
me just say, I would definitely not be anyone who would boo me.
Thanks for joining us, Bonnie. Yeah, so really good having you on, and hope we can speak to you again.
We've got Victoria with us now on the second part of the podcast. Let's see. So we're going to talk a bit about cosplays.
Can I just mention something?
What?
Victoria, I feel bad to admit this, but I actually just completely forgot to check the list again of all your cosplays.
Oh yeah, do you want me to message it to you?
No, I can find it here now.
This is completely going out of my comfort zone because I'm not really good with like cosplays and costumes and stuff like that.
Okay, here's the list. Victoria cosplayed as A New Hope Princess Leia, Slave Leia, Ewok Leia, X-Wing Pilot, Jaina Solo, Jedi Bits of Jaina Solo, Ola, and Ahsoka Tano. So it's a really cool cosplay. And now that I think about it, I actually remember the Star Wars Underworld, specifically Quincy Cal doing a video of FIFA Celebration 6 in Ahsoka cosplay. Yeah, I remember that. And that was a pretty cool video. And that Ahsoka cosplay must have taken a lot of effort. Sure.
Yeah, it did.
Yeah. So,
Sorry, Daniel, I'm just trying to remember, like, I'm sure, like, I read somewhere or I heard somewhere how long it took you to get all the little details, details like makeup on and all that. Like, do you want to talk about how long it takes details like that to wear for cosplays?
When I get into that costume, it usually takes about 2 to 3 hours doing the paint and then putting everything on. My boyfriend is actually the one who paints me and does like the face details and everything, and he's got that down pretty quick, so that doesn't take too long. But it definitely took a while to slowly piece the outfit together and make it exactly the way I wanted to try to mimic the cartoon as ideally as possible, because you have different ways you can approach a costume. You can either try to make it just as it is on TV, or you can try to make a more realistic version of it, so you might change things. Like they have Ahsoka at Disney World for the Star Wars events, and the way they did that costume is, you know, a bit different than how I did mine, because they need to make it functional for a couple different girls to wear, and the girls need to be able to interact easily with the public and the kids. So there's things about that after it that are different than how I did mine.
Yeah.
Because I was trying to make mine look like, you know, Ahsoka just walked out of the TV.
Pretty interesting. And which has been your favorite one so far?
Definitely been Ahsoka, because Clone Wars is obviously the big thing right now. It's the most recognizable for kids. Some kids it's awesome when they recognize Princess Leia, but I've totally been mistaken for Padme sometimes because they haven't seen her. their parents just haven't shown it to them, but like every kid has seen Clone Wars.
Yeah.
So and it's awfully, it's more of like a wow factor for little kids because you don't look normal, you know, you're painted a different color and you've got like this weird thing on your head, so it definitely gets just way more attention.
Yeah.
And I want, just one more, I want to put Daniel out of his comfort zone even more right now. Daniel, if you had to wear a costume of any Star Wars character, who would it be?
You know I'd go for a clone trooper.
Yeah, I know, because you always pick the easy options.
Well, it's not the easy option, it's just, yeah, it's the easy option actually. Well, it can be hard to make, like, if you want to make, if you want to make, like, the armor and the helmet and...
It depends on the character.
Well, yeah, if you're going to go for a plain clone trooper, that's going to be easy, but if you want to go, like, for, I don't know, Fives or Echo or Rex or something, it's going to be harder.
And now, Daniel, you have the honor of asking me who I would cosplay as.
Do I now? I don't even need to ask, you just ask yourself.
Why would I ask myself? I don't talk to myself.
Okay, what's yours then, Rari? What would you dress up as?
The same as my top three Star Wars characters.
Obi-Wan,
Commander Wolf, and Dengar. But Dengar most of all, because he's like unique.
I thought you had Ahsoka in there.
I'll play as Ahsoka.
Oh, okay. I'll pretend I didn't say that.
I think it's pretty much encrypted in my brain right now.
I can't imagine you as Ahsoka.
I don't want to imagine.
So have you, got anything else to say to Victoria? I can't keep a straight face now.
Daniel, I should hope so. We've got to discuss a 1-2 front and under on with her as well.
I was I was talking about her personally.
Oh, right.
Cosplays or dread. We'll move pace by pace, remember.
Yeah, no.
In an order.
Yeah. We have to follow the script, if not, it's all ruined.
Now that I think about it, like, I was at a convention last weekend called Invasion Belfast. Daniel will know all about that one.
Oh, yes.
And there was, like, a ton of costumes at it, and, like, the Emerald Garrison and the people that organized the event, they put a lot of effort into their costumes for sure. I'm not saying you don't. You do, of course, Victoria. I'm just pointing out they also put in a lot of effort. Like, some of their costumes, like, just look unreal and so accurate. Unbelievable. Like, Darth Revan and Darth Nihilus and characters like that. Like, Gamorrean Guard as well, from Piccolo Groovy.
Oh, yeah. The C6, there was the Gamorrean Guard, and that just blew my mind because it was, like, a complete outfit. I mean, it's one thing to maybe... get like the head, but like literally had the feet and the hands and the entire bodysuit and things like that are just really, you can't get anything better than that in a costume.
You'll need a big fat suit for the Gamorrean Guard.
Yep. That's definitely one where you could be a girl and do it and no one would know. Now, same thing as with some, you know, normal stormtroopers and Imperial Guards. I have a lot of girlfriends who do armor costumes, but do it normally, not like, you know, with boobs and stuff. And most people assume it's a guy under there, and it's not.
Now that I think of that, I remember seeing that Bo-Katan, Bo-Katan costume at Celebration 6. I remember seeing pictures of that one. That was pretty awesome.
Yeah, it was so great to see. I think we'll see a little more Bo-Katan cosplayers, but she's the first and looked awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was definitely one of the best ones at Celebration 6, in my opinion. Yours is up there, definitely, Victoria.
So, let's just put this to Rari. A war on two fronts, what do you think about it?
Well, good episode. I want to hear your thoughts on it first, Daniel, because I actually still don't know if you liked it or not.
I was debating a lot. I mean, I love the episode and the way they've put it, and yet there's something that I just won't click with me on it. I don't know what it is.
Sorry, Daniel, but personally, one thing at times in the Clone Wars, that I've sometimes not been too happy about is sometimes they try to put introduction stories into newsreels. You know, Percy, I think more acts need introduction episodes, like a one, two, front, you know. That's just my personal opinion, but that's kind of why I like the one, two, front a bit. Like, it was actually introducing an act,
I mean,
rather than just being in a newsreel.
Club fan.
Like, yeah.
Yeah, I'll go ahead.
Like, the funny thing is, like, the idea is so simple.
Yeah.
And it contains rebels, blah, blah, blah.
But they're not allowed to attack them.
They're not allowed to help them.
Yeah, they're just there to...
To me, that's one of the few flaws of the episode. I think it was a bit cheap, to be honest.
Yeah, like, we're just here to defend you. If you get killed, that's not our problem.
I know. That's a problem. Like, we actually just don't care if you die.
But I mean,
that's the impression I got.
A lot of clone fans are hating this because they don't see clones. But I mean, I've explained to them thousands of times the Clone Wars, just because it's got the Clone Wars' names, doesn't mean every single episode has to have clones.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay, there is Rex in this fancy, distinctive, like, armor.
I don't even know why, but for some reason, I actually much prefer Rex's underarm outfit to his normal outfit.
And you don't like Rex, that's the funny thing.
I know. Like, to be honest, like, Rex and Anakin, you know, my two most hated characters in the Clone Wars, well, the main ones, like, of course, there are others I've hated more.
Yeah.
Like, Orthony or Morley, I could go on the list.
Yeah.
But, like, they're the main characters that I don't like most on the course. But, you know, Rex and Anakin, they did have their purpose in this episode. I'll give them that. I'll give them credit where it's due. They did have them on this episode. It's Obi-Wan, my favorite Star Wars character of all time.
Yeah.
Who had no purpose in this episode, I do have to say.
He's just like, let's bring Rex, Anakin, Obi-Wan, and Ahsoka, and let's just put them in an arc.
Yeah, it's just an excuse to have them all there. But looking ahead to frontrunners, I'm just looking forward a lot to seeing Anakin, Rex, and Obi-Wan just go bye-bye, pretty much.
And I mean, what do you think about it, Victoria, if you've got any opinions on it?
On that episode?
Yeah.
It's always weird to see Ahsoka acting, like, normally, you know, because she's just so, obviously, since she started and her being, like, basically the youngest Padawan or to begin with, you know, she's always been really mature for her age. So I don't expect her to, like, I guess, be prey to normal girly emotions, like having crushes and stuff.
Yeah.
So it's kind of hard to, like, wrap my head around that. It's not that I don't like it. It's just weird. It's weird to see her, like, crushing on Lux. Jealous of Lux.
I just thought that very weird.
Mm-hmm. Weird is the word. Like, it's not bad, it's just weird.
It's like, random.
Sorry, Dad, can I just interject something?
Go ahead.
Did either of you know that the character... did either of you know the character Stila Guerrera is actually an adult and not a teenager like Lux or Ahsoka?
No, I didn't.
Oh.
I totally assumed she was around the same age as them.
Yeah, she doesn't look like...
To be honest, she's like... To be honest, I don't know. I don't think she looks like an adult or a teenager. Just like maybe a few years older than Lux, no more.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I was reading up some info and like Wikipedia from their source like says she's an adult. And yet she still has a crush on Lux. So I just find that...
Yeah.
Disgusting, to be honest. Like, it just gives me even more reason to want it to be Lux Soka.
Yeah, but how old is Lux supposed to be at this point? I mean,
I don't even know. Like,
they're like 16, 17, and she's 18. That's not, you know, that far off.
Ahsoka's supposed to be 16, I'm sure.
Yeah, but like if you're going with the general, well, I don't know how it is in Star Wars universe, but if it's like 18 makes you an adult, well then. You know,
yeah,
be like a year or two older than Lux, and you know, the other girl. I always forget her name.
Stila,
yeah. That Stila could be 18, and like, well, that makes her an adult, but still makes her a kid.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I think like they would have met. The source would have mentioned if like.
Yeah.
if 18 was a teenager.
You're so just thinking that she's like 25 hitting on a 16-year-old.
Okay, maybe not that old, but yeah, something along those lines.
Something around there.
And I mean, yeah. Looking ahead to Front Runners, I still can't get my head around why they want a separatist tank.
And I even gave you a plausible explanation.
I know, but I didn't read it.
They want to eliminate that puppet.
Wait, what puppet?
The Onderon King, like, you know,
oh.
The one who forced Onderon to align with the separatists.
Yeah.
And, like, they even, like, I remember reading up info about Frontrunners, like, they said the leader of the resistance is to be named, and I actually have to ask you two, who do you think that leader of the rebels is going to be?
I can't think. No clue who it could be.
I'm thinking,
like, is it someone we haven't seen, or someone they're gonna appoint?
Yeah, I think it's someone we know. I'm thinking the character Sora Guerrera, to be honest. He's a bit headstrong and strikes me as someone who would be the resistant. Why do I keep saying resistance? Rebel leader.
Yeah.
Resistant rebel. Mm.
I'm just going to call them freedom fighters.
That works too.
Yeah, it works.
Technically, they are freedom fighters.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. I mean, I don't see, like, clones coming to save them in this arc.
Yeah. I mean, like, we got the clone pilot Hawk briefly in the last episode, and Rex is going to leave in the next one. You know, that, to be honest, like, says we're done with clones for this episode. I mean, maybe they'll, like, make a cameo in that fine Rex over the air, but it's going to be nothing more.
Rex is just there, like, to train the people, and then he basically buggers off.
Yeah. And to be honest, I've got to the stage where I'm okay with that, you know. It's gone to the stage where they barely use clones as much as they arguably should on the show.
Yeah.
That I really just don't even care anymore, to be honest.
And I mean...
Yeah, again, back to Onderon, anyway.
I mean, going back to War on Two Fronts, Abraham Chen on Facebook said, I think it was a good episode in terms of special effects, the dynamics better. Ahsoka and Lux, I can see, are developing a lot more, and she is also having to struggle with jealousy as well as her conflicted feelings. The lack of action does not make the episode too bad. In my opinion, I give it an 8.5. I mean, the effects have got better this season, that's for sure.
Oh, definitely.
The one thing I have to say, though, is, you know, and this is an obvious thing that I have to say anyway, this episode was never going to be as good as Revival.
No.
I mean, anyone who was just for it could have been. I mean,
and I think that's why they put Revival first, probably.
It's exactly why. That and they wanted to continue the more Survive story.
But, I mean...
I just don't even see why they didn't decide to continue it. Away anyway.
They needed to sort that out, because I mean, Adi Gallia dies in Revival, and she appears in, like, the Jedi Temple in the episode after.
Yeah.
I mean, just like, what?
And there's still people questioning that as well.
I know, I mean, get your head around that she's there, and it's an episode that happened before. I mean, in season one, we saw, like, in the middle of season one, like, Christophsis randomly thrown in there.
Even before the movie.
Yeah, it's like based before the movie. Yet you don't get it until halfway through season one.
And then season two. Oh, Cat and Mouse. That's even before Hidden Enemy.
Wow.
Yeah.
Actually, now that you point it out, I never realised that. Wow, you learn something new every day, don't you?
I always point out things to you, of course you learn new things. Like, I have my own theories about what's going to happen in this act, but I don't want to say them in case... in case either of you blame me if I'm right.
It's like, spoiler alert.
But I have a feeling, though, that at least one of the rebels will turn out to be a traitor in one way or another. That's my general feeling.
Yeah. So... we've also got a new upcoming Star Wars video game titled First Assault, which apparently is going to be exclusive to the Xbox 360. So, I mean, I've not really heard much about this game. Have you, Ruari?
I've heard a bit. I've heard that it's called Star Wars Vest Assault and it's exclusive to Xbox PC.
Oh, you don't say.
Well, apparently.
Since I did not just say that.
Well, I did see a cover and put a picture, which looked okay.
I'm not quite sure what it's about.
It hasn't, like, they haven't really mentioned what it's about, you know, so.
It was your idea thrown in.
I don't know, like, I have many ideas for Star Wars video games, but who knows. But I am going to get so much criticism for this, but, like, I mean, people, it's not Battlefront 3, that's time has passed.
Yeah, it's called First Assault, not Battlefront 3, and it's for the Xbox 360.
I generally have to wonder, you know.
Yeah.
Star Wars video games, or Lucasfilm with their video games, have a bit of a run going. Like, they like to say 1 year is kiddie games, shall I say, like Kinect, which is obviously a kid's game.
Yeah.
And then this year we're getting 1313, and I presume First Assault will be coming out next year. I'd be really surprised if it came out this year, to be honest.
I mean, it's.
So I'm genuinely wondering what it is, to be honest.
It is annoying as well that they've made it an Xbox 360 exclusive.
You know, so I just don't even really care, to be honest.
I mean, people that don't have the Xbox, well, if it's a crap. Excuse my language again. If it's a bad game, they'll think they've got free from it if you've not got Xbox 360. Now,
yeah, I can just, like, drive Graham into buying it.
Now, this is the part that I feel sorry for Victoria.
What?
It's 10 minutes of Rari's rant.
10 minutes? I thought we agreed on 5.
You agreed on 10 before the show, I'm pretty sure.
We did?
Yeah. So,
Daniel, I barely survived 40-minute rant once. I don't think I can survive 10 this time.
So this is the part that we're not going to like, but Rari's going to have so much fun. So what's your topic in Rari's rant this week?
How about I rant about how Daniel always makes me extend the length of time of my rant?
Fine, we'll put it down to 5.
Okay, so my rant this week is on Hasbro, of course.
Oh,
are they daft or are they crazy?
Both?
Yeah. To be honest, I don't even know if either of you noticed it, but I actually referenced the Harry Potter quote from the movies there.
Actually, yeah.
Yeah. When they were, like, mentioning Dumbledore in the newspapers, like, their mentor was going, is he daft or is he crazy? I'm saying it has been daft or any crazy.
So, your rant begins.
I'm genuinely confused. Are they daft or are they crazy or are they both, to be honest?
I mean, I'm not quite sure what they're playing at.
To be honest, like, going off the most recent Hasbro match, you know, I'm all for Star Wars Angry Birds, to be honest. Like, I think it's a great idea. The thing I don't like is a whole Hasbro theme dedicated to Angry Birds. That is stupid. I mean, Star Wars Angry Birds released by Hasbro, it's just crazy. I mean, it's even like Hasbro doesn't even care about their 3¾-inch action figure line anymore. It's all these little things they can throw in. Fighter parts, Angry Birds, that sort of thing. It's just ridiculous.
Yeah.
I mean, did you know they had, like, a exclusive press release at New York Comic Con, like, on Wednesday night or something?
Yeah.
Not one single action figure was shown. Everything was Angry Birds this and Angry Birds that.
They've just, like, gone mad. I mean, I've seen pictures of the Angry Birds set on Facebook, and it was just, like, an AT-T... No, it's an AT-AT with Stormtroopers and Vader on it, and then just, like, different rebels and a slingshot that you just shoot at it.
I am probably still going to fail to remember what this song is, but I remember what hearing it in one of Dan Grievous' videos, but it was like, bird, bird.
You're not don't start singing that song.
Oh, God. I don't even remember it anyway.
What is, it's not the one that I'm thinking of from Family Guy.
Yeah, I'll need to message Dan Beavis to send me that link later. But, yeah, anyway, getting off Angry Birds, well, I already mentioned Fighter Pods, so I really don't want to be sick again, so I won't mention them again.
Yeah.
Basically, the Clone Wars line is screwed. Move along, move along.
I mean, I got, just saying about the Clone Wars, I got Commander Fox Phase 2 in the post today. And I opened it, and I mean, what's the problem with no articulation at all on the feet, or the knees, or the ankles?
Who knows? It's a kid's line, Daniel. You've got to face
that. And I just noticed, because I've obviously not bought like clones in a bit, but that Fox does not have any articulation, none in the hand. Like, it's completely attached to the arm, not like they've done like with Phase 2 Cody or Phase 2 clones, like it comes off or it can break easily.
Sorry to interrupt, but you know what amuses me so much?
Yeah?
The parents have been complaining as far as kids go that, like, their articulated hands can't hold the weapons and that they come off easily. Like, now, what I have to say is, like, one, Hasbro, the simpler reason would be to go back to ball hinged wrists because they don't break off. And two, I mean, this is the more obvious one, they're definitely not going to stick in the figure's hands the weapons if they're not articulated wrists.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, the new figures are good for display purposes.
Yeah.
Shit.
Are you wanting to throw in anything from Invasion while we're here?
Let me think. I found it really, really amazing. I was very pleased with myself that a couple of the cast members remembered my name, so that was pleasing.
Did you sort out the video problem? I heard about that on Facebook.
Oh no, it's still an ongoing problem.
Hopefully
I can sort it out, because like, I'll actually be like a complete idiot if I have to ask them again. Like, Jeremy Bullock I could easily get.
Yeah.
Like any of Invasion, Belfast, yeah. I'd still feel it like a complete idiot if I had to.
Yeah.
Like, I'm actually working on my blog post right now for it.
Yeah.
It's really cool. There was a lot of costume characters and the props were really nice. This is something interesting I actually bring up in the blog post I'm doing on it. I actually posted pictures of around 16 costume characters that are set to appear there. I didn't see them all, but there were even some that were actually released in the pictures that were there as well, which was interesting. The Darth Revan and Gamorrean Grunt ones I mentioned earlier, they weren't actually in those photos.
Yeah.
And I didn't see Sev, didn't see... I'm trying to think of the ones I didn't see. Didn't see Darth Nihilus either, actually. There were a lot I didn't see. The Kit Fisto one as well. I saw the Maris Brood one briefly, and that costume... Well, all I can say is the person who made the Maris Brood costume put a heck of a lot of effort into it. It was so accurate, it was unreal.
Yeah. Yeah. So, have you got anything else you'd like to add, Victoria, in general?
No, just looking forward to more Clone Wars, of course, because I think there's a lot of exciting stuff coming in Season 5, and that's about it.
Yeah.
And someone here knows a lot of spoilers.
Do not. I'm going to have to start doing like Kyle does and get a spoiler alert button.
Yeah.
Don't worry, my lips are sealed, but maybe the keyboard isn't.
Yeah. Yeah, so this has been fun. Apart from the very small technical problems that have happened during this episode.
Yeah, you can never escape those.
No, you can't. Well, we managed to escape them last week, apart from the popcorn. Yeah. So, I think it's time to wrap this episode up.
Way to state the obvious, Sherlock.
Anything else you'd like to add, Rari, while we're here?
Yeah, tomorrow can't come quickly enough. Oh, and one last thing. It's past 11 p.m, so it's past my thinking time.
Okay, then I better shut this episode down. So make sure to check out our YouTube channels. Mine is Okay, I'm gonna start again. Make sure to check out our YouTube It's 11 p.m. guys, you got to understand.
You're done.
So mine is www.youtube.com/user/14MrDass. Rari says
mine is youtube.com/user/stepthisdestroyer.
Also check out Victoria's Facebook page, www.facebook.com/scruffyrebelcosplayer, and also check out Bonnie's website at http://2.2. Bonnie.
It's not 2 dots, oh my god.
2 dots, 2 lines, Bonnie.
It's double dots.
I don't care. Bonnie. PS.com.
Oh, come
please.
On.
Please, he's like, please.
Bonnie.
Actually, I just think of it like a piece of it.
Yeah. So, yeah. Check out.
Well, Bonnie said that, it was said earlier, so.
So, check her out at BonniePs.com. So, yeah, so. That's been us for tonight. Entertaining show. We've had Bonnie, Victoria, and obviously Rari.
Yay! Bonnie the Magnificent.
You keep doing the same every week.
I actually keep forgetting to mention this quote to my fellow host and the guest every week that on the last 2 weeks, so I have to mention this for this time.
So. From
hey, you didn't let me mention it. You've been the awesome and I've been the incredible.
You can just post on Facebook all the things that you need to after.
Well, there's no point saying it after, I have to say it to you too.
Okay, go ahead.
I just said it.
I was...
You've been the awesome and I've been the incredible.
Okay, I'm not going to listen. From Bonnie, Victoria, Rari, and me, this has been tonight's episode, and may the Force be with you, Star Wars fans.
Always.